You're listening to the audio production of Signs of Life by David Jeremiah, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Tommy Cresswell.
Introduction. It was October 27, 2003, when I sent this email to our church family at Shadow Mountain Community Church, the congregation I pastor in El Cajon, California. This has surely been one of the most difficult times in our church's history. Last night, I stood on the campus and prayed that God would spare our facilities. During the next couple of hours, the wind shifted, and, at least for now, the campus is safe. We are still in the evacuation mode because the fire department has told us that if the winds were to shift, we could be back in jeopardy again. Southern California's Cedar Fire was the state's largest wildfire in over a century. It was a confluence of 15 individual fires and the hot, dry Santa Ana winds. More than 2,300 homes were destroyed, 15 lives were lost, and more than 280,000 acres were incinerated. Many precious folks in our congregation lost their homes to the voracious flames. In the mountains just above our church campus is a small community called Crest. Almost every family in that community was severely impacted by the firestorm. These people were our neighbors, and they desperately needed our help. So, for the next 6 weeks, we adopted the Crest community. We collected blankets, clothing, and toys. We took offerings for the needy in all of our weekend services. We provided over 1,000 meals, delivered 2 truckloads of water, gave out nearly $200,000, provided temporary housing for many, and counseled and prayed with dozens of individuals and families. The firestorm is now a part of San Diego history, but a whiff of smoke in the air on a hot, dry day brings back a powerful rush of memories. Cross-country compassion. Now, fast forward to March 15, 2007. I was in Greensboro, North Carolina, where Turning Point, our radio and television ministry, was hosting a breakfast for pastors. I was teaching the series of messages that inspired this book, and we had combined efforts with the organization Feed the Children to provide 30,000 pounds of food for these pastors to distribute to needy families in their communities. One pastor came from across the state line in Virginia. His community had been hit hard by plant closings, and over 10,000 jobs had been lost. As he left the breakfast that morning, he knew exactly where he was going to deliver one of the boxes of food, but the recipient of the other box was a mystery. When he stopped at his office, he found a form on his secretary's desk from a family seeking help to pay a utility bill. Mystery solved. The address on the form led him to a mobile home located on a gravel road. The family of 6 was existing on the husband's small disability check, plus a meager amount the wife earned working at a convenience store. The pastor's heart was filled with compassion when he saw the small children in this poverty-stricken home. The next day, a relative of this young mother called the pastor to express her gratitude for the kindness that had been shown to her extended family. She shared this comment from the mother who had received the box of food and essentials. How did he know we needed those things, especially the soap and toilet paper? Compassion is contagious. After I heard this story, I shared it with our congregation when I was teaching about living an open-handed life. Sitting in the auditorium that day was a woman visiting from New York. She slipped $25 in cash into one of our pew envelopes and wrote these words on the outside. I am only visiting this church this one Sunday. I am from New York. If there is any way, please see that the family Pastor Jeremiah spoke of in his sermon this morning receives this. We sent the $25 to the pastor in Virginia, who in turn described the incident for his congregation that following Sunday evening. He challenged the 98 people in attendance to have compassion for those around them who were in need. At the end of the service, a man came forward and added $20 to the initial cash gift. When the pastor arrived home, an envelope of cash was taped to his door, and another was waiting for him on the secretary's desk in the morning. On Monday afternoon, the pastor gave that needy family a check for $250. Compassion is contagious. The Church's Treasures. According to legend, St. Lawrence, the 3rd century treasurer of the early church's resources, was brought before the authorities, who demanded that he hand over all the church's treasures to the emperor. Lawrence compliantly asked for 3 days to gather the church's treasures. He promised to then reveal to the Roman magistrate the extensive riches of the church. On the 3rd day, Lawrence appeared and brought with him orphans, the poor, the lame, and the widows in distress. Pointing to them, he said, "These are the treasures of the church." And for that reply, he was sentenced to death. The Bible mentions the poor more than 150 times. If we add to that figure the number of times God's Word talks about caring for the widows, the fatherless, and the needy, we have more than 300 references reminding us of our responsibility to help people in need. These scriptures have made such an impression on my own heart and life that I have included them at the end of this book. The Greatest Commandment. One day a lawyer asked Jesus to identify the greatest commandment in the law. Our Lord's answer to that question is one of the reasons why I wrote this book. Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Matthew 22, 37 through 40. We all know that we are to love God, but exactly how are we supposed to do that? Jesus answered the question like this: "We love God by loving the people He created." Jesus taught that loving the least among His brothers was the same as loving Him. Matthew 25, 40. In fact, He goes so far as to say that the entire Bible is summarized by these two commands: to love God and love our neighbors. No wonder God's Word has so much to say about caring for the poor and needy. Responding to God's commands. In this book, you will find 40 devotional readings designed to help you express your love for God by reaching out in compassion to others. The book is organized around the 5 signs of life: dusty shoes, worn-out knees, rolled-up sleeves, open hands, and outstretched arms. Each chapter ends with what we have labeled signs of life. These practical suggestions will help you put the day's devotional thought into action. At the back of the book, we have included some detailed suggestions for using signs of life as a call to action in your own life and in the life of your church. We have also developed a 40-day church campaign that will enable you to get everyone in your congregation involved in living out Jesus' great commandment. Ascending to Heaven. From Isaac Lieb Peretz, a Jewish writer, comes this captivating tale. In a small Jewish town in Russia, there is a rabbi who disappears every Friday. His devoted disciples boast that during those hours, their rabbi goes up to heaven and talks to God. A stranger moves into town, and he's skeptical about all this, so he decides to check things out. He hides and watches. The rabbi gets up in the morning, says his prayers, and then dresses in peasant clothes. He grabs an axe, goes off into the woods, and cuts some firewood, which he then hauls to a shack on the outskirts of the village. There, an old woman and her 6 sons live. He leaves them the wood, enough for a week, and then sneaks back home. Having observed the rabbi's actions, the newcomer stays on in the village and becomes his disciple. And whenever he hears one of the villagers say, "On Friday morning our rabbi ascends all the way to heaven," the newcomer quietly adds, "if not higher." As we start our signs of life journey together, our goal is to, like this rabbi, go up higher, to draw closer to God by serving His people, and not just on Friday, but on every day of the week. David Jeremiah, San Diego, California, June 2007. Signs of Life. Day 1. Signs of Life. This book is a mirror by which you can see yourself as others see you. Bobbing on the sea like a pelican, The cruise queen was a floating mansion, as long as a gymnasium and dazzling white against the blue waters of the Aegean. But something was wrong. The yacht seemed strangely deserted. As silently as death, the detective boarded the ship, pistol in hand, looking for signs of life. How often have you watched a scene like that in a movie or on television? One of the reasons whodunit shows are so popular is because there's a little detective in us all. We're all looking for signs of life, hints of our identity, and hidden secrets. Remember Sherlock Holmes? He could unravel a person's entire life by the mud on his shoes, the calluses on his hands, and the threads on his coat. Many of us have played Sherlock Holmes at airports or in waiting rooms, whiling away the time by people watching, constructing a silent profile of their lives by their clothing, accessories, body language, facial appearance, and mannerisms. The hidden person of the heart shows up in all kinds of ways. Your appearance and your home environment are extensions of your thoughts and values. Others can tell a great deal about us by the way we look, the car we drive, the language we use, the habits we keep, the friends we make, and the places we frequent. It's amazing how quickly we can size someone up, or how quickly someone can size us up. As Christ's followers, we should exhibit certain signs of life that evidence our commitment to our Lord and His kingdom. Some of these are obvious to those who see us in our private moments when we're at prayer, reading our Bibles, writing our tithing checks, and resisting personal temptations. Most people, however, don't have access to such personal moments. They see us from across the street, across the fence, across the hall, across the office, across the miles, or across the pews. How do those people recognize that we are God's ambassadors? It's by our smile, our joy, our compassion in the face of another's misfortune, our friendliness, our simple lifestyle, our willingness to commit random acts of kindness, our benevolence, our social ministries, our tears, our generosity, our public expressions of our private faith. One man approached a cadet at the military academy at West Point a couple of years ago and said to him, "You must be a Christian." The surprised cadet said that he was indeed a follower of Christ. "But how did you know?" asked the young man. "I saw you in the dining hall," replied the guest. "It was loud and chaotic there with bands playing, a pep rally going on, and 1,000 cadets eating and laughing and shouting. But I saw you, in the middle of it all, quietly bow your head before eating your meal." Does anyone ever come up to you and say, "You must be a Christian"? Do they ask a reason for the hope within you? Has anyone recently said, "There's something different about you. I can't figure it out, but I want what you have"? Egged on by an entertainment industry and national media that often paint us in a negative light, our society tends to have an unfavorable view of Christians. At the same time, however, the very culture in which we live desperately needs genuine people who display signs of abundant living. This world is starved for love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, faithfulness, radiance, simplicity, honesty, and compassion. Christians specialize in these things. It's not enough just to talk about the Lord, as important as that is. It's not enough to serve Him in secret with our acts of private devotion. We have to display the lifestyle of the Nazarene in the midst of our corrupt culture. Jesus called it letting our light shine before men, that they might see our good works and glorify our Father in heaven. The Apostle Paul said, "Do all things without complaining, that you may become blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world." Philippians 2:14-15. Think of this book as a sort of mirror that can help you see yourself as others see you. It's also like a doctor's office where you can examine yourself for signs of life. And it's a pep rally where you can be encouraged to walk the talk. All that under one cover. After all, We're not deserted yachts bobbing in paradise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.